Today, we will have some basic knowledge about what is CPC, that is Civil Procedure Code, and why was it enacted. So, without wasting any time, let's begin with the question and answer round, and let's start gaining some basic knowledge about the Civil Procedure Code. Let's start with the first question, that is Order 18, Rule 4, Clause 1 of the Code. The examination chief of the witness shall be recorded under what terms? The options are A, an affidavit; B, by the commissioner appointed by the court; C, by the judge; or D, all of the above. The correct answer to this question is option A, that is, the examination in chief of the witness shall be recorded on the affidavit as per Order 18, Rule 4, Clause 1. The next question is, which of the following is not a sufficient cause for granting adjournment? The options are A, non-service of summons; B, sickness of the party, his witness or his counsel; C, reasonable time for preparation of a case; or D, non-examination of a witness present in the court. The correct answer to this question is option D, that is, non-examination of a witness present in the court is not a sufficient cause for granting adjournment in any matter. Moving on to the next question, which is, no evidence is required to be pleaded in which of the following? The options are A, counter affidavit; B, written statement; C, writ petition; or D, all of the above. The correct answer to this question is option D, that is, in all of the above, that is, counterclaim, written statement, and writ petition, no evidence is required to be pleaded. Let's now move on to the next question, that is, the code provides for which of the following? The options are A, mandatory injunction; B, temporary injunction; C, permanent injunction; or D, all of the above. Correct answer to this question is option B, that is, the court provides only for temporary injunction and no other form of injunction. The next question is, a person is an indigent person within the meaning of Order 33, Rule 1 of the court, if he is not possessed of which of the following? The options are A, any means to pay the fees payable on the plaint; B, sufficient means of his livelihood; C, sufficient means to enable him to pay the fees prescribed by law for the plaint; or D, all of the above. The correct answer to this question is option C, that is, a person is an indigent person if he is not possessed of the sufficient means to enable him to pay the fees prescribed by law for the plaint. Now let's move on to the next question, which is, an ex parte decree can be set aside on the ground of which of the following? The options are A, being prevented by any sufficient cause from appearance; or B, summons not duly served; C, both A and B above; or D, neither A nor B. The correct answer to this question is option C, that is, both A and B above are correct. That means to say, being prevented by any sufficient cause from appearance and the summons not duly served can be treated as a valid reason for setting aside an ex parte decree. The next question is, a caveat shall not remain in form after the expiration of how many days? The options are A, 60 days; B, 90 days; C, 120 days; or D, 3 months. The correct answer to this question is option B, that is, a caveat shall not remain in force after the expiry of 90 days. So now let's see and understand what caveat means. Let's now learn some basic facts and information about caveat. What is caveat? Caveat is a notice, especially in a probate, that certain actions may not be taken without informing the person who gave the notice. Caveat is basically a formal notice or a warning given by a party to a judge or another court officer concerning his or her behavior and requesting a suspension of the proceeding until the merits of the notice or warning are determined. Caveat is basically nothing but a notice given by a person informing the court that another person may file a suit or an application against him, and that the court must give the caveator a fair hearing before deciding any matter brought before it in the relevant case. After gaining information and knowledge on caveat, let's move to another question, which is, in a suit against the state government, who may sign the plaint on behalf of the government? The options are A. Chief Minister of the state, B. Chief Secretary of the state, C. Governor of the state, or D. A person who, by a general or a special order, appointed in this behalf by the government. The correct answer to this question is option D. That means to say a person who, by general or special order, appointed in this behalf by the government, will only be authorized to sign the plaint on behalf of the government. Now let's move to the next question, which is, a suit may be defeated due to which of the following reasons? The options are A. Non-jointer of the necessary parties, B. Misjointer of the necessary parties, C. Misjointer of the proper party, or D. Non-jointer of the proper party. Correct answer to this question is option A, that is, due to non-joiner of a necessary party, a suit may be defeated. The next question is, interpleader suit cannot be instituted in which of the following options? The options are A, for determining the relation between a property and the persons claiming it, B, where a suit is pending in which the rights of all parties can properly be decided, C, for any property which relates to two persons but which is being held by a third person for the time being, or D, for getting himself absolved from the liability to keep the property which is not being held by him. The correct answer to this question is option B, that is, an interpleader suit cannot be instituted where a suit is pending in which the rights of all parties can be properly be decided. So now let's see what is an interpleader suit. Need some basic knowledge about what is interpleader suit. Interpleader suit is a suit that is filed when a plaintiff on behalf of the claimant files a suit for choosing the actual owner of the property. Then it is called an interpleader suit. An interpleader is defined in section 88 of the Civil Procedure Code. There are some conditions that are to be met for filing an interpleader suit. Those are debt, money, property, either movable or immovable property should be in the dispute. Second condition, the two defendants are there in the suit. Third, both defendants can claim each other for the property or money. Fourth, the person who has to pay the debt to the defendant is not valid for any interest. Fifth, the claimant is willing to pay the debt or some amount of money or property to the defendant. Sixth, that suit are not pending in this matter. And seventh, and the last one, that this suit cannot be filed twice and the judgment is given in res judicata. So after gaining knowledge and information about the interpleader suit, let's now move on to the next question, which is, in a suit, the list of witnesses has to be filed by the parties at what stage and at time? The options are A, at any time, B, before the settlement of the issues, C, after settlement of the issues, or D, any of the above. The correct answer to this question is option C, that is, after the settlement of the issues, the list of witnesses has to be filed by the parties in the court and it is also to be given to the another party. The next question is, a suit filed on behalf of a minor is treated as what? The options are A, cannot be withdrawn, B, can be withdrawn as a matter of right, C, can be withdrawn only with the leave of the court, or D, none of the above. The correct answer to this question is option C, that is, a suit filed on behalf of a minor can be withdrawn only with the leave of the court. The next question is, a witness who has already been examined can be recalled under Order 18 Rule 17 of the court by which of the following authorities? The options are A, by the court, B, by the opposite party, C, by the party calling the witness, or D, any of the above. The correct answer to this question is option A, that is, a witness who has already been examined can be recalled under Order 18, Rule 17 of the court only by the court. So now let's gain some knowledge about Order 18, Rule 17. Let's now see what does Rule 17 states. Rule 17 states that court may recall and examine the witness. This rule states that the court may at any stage of a suit recall any witness who has been examined and may, subject to the law of evidence for the time being in force, put such questions to him as the court thinks fit. Let's move on to the next question, which is a party filing affidavit in reply to interrogatories can be done what? The options are A, can be cross-examined upon it, B, the other party can adduce evidence to contradict it, C, neither A nor B, D, both A and B above. The correct answer to this question is option C, that is, neither A nor B is correct. That means to say, a party filing affidavit in reply to the interrogatories cannot be cross-examined upon it, as well as the other party cannot adduce evidence to contradict. Let's now move on to the last question for the day. That is, which provision of the code deals with the consequences of the disobedience of the injunction granted by the court? The options are A, Order 39 Rule 2A, B, Order 39 Rule 2, C, Order 39 Rule 3, or D, Order 39 Rule 3A. The correct answer to this question is option A, that is, Order 39 Rule 2A deals with the consequences of the disobedience of the injunction granted by the court. Quote. So now, before signing off, let's just have some basic knowledge about Order 39, Rule 2A. See, what does Order 39, Rule 2A states? The Rule 2A states the consequence of the disobedience or the breach of injunction. As per this rule, clause 1, in the case of disobedience of any injunction granted or other order made under rule 1 or rule 2 or the breach of any terms on which the injunction was granted or the order made, the court granting the injunction or making the order or any court to which the suit or the proceeding is transferred may order the property of the person guilty of such disobedience or breach to be attached and may also order such person to be detained in a civil prison for a term not exceeding 3 months, unless the meantime the court directs his release. The clause 2 of this rule states, no attachment made under this rule shall remain in force more than 1 year, at the end of which time, if the disobedience or breach continues, the property attached may be sold, and out of the proceeds, the court may award such compensation as it thinks fit in the injured party, and shall pay the balance, if any, to the party entitled thereto. That's all for today. This was the end of our first presentation. Hope you all liked it and hope this presentation or video was able to teach you something about the Civil Procedure Code. Thank you for watching it. Thank you.